soldiers for sale worldwide. That technology spread through Skull and Bones. I mean, quantify what Skull and Bones is from your deep research and what Sutton discovered. Then Aaron's got some points.
Well, the order, I do believe that it is connected with the Illuminati. And there are some pretty sound research that connects them. It is a German order. There's no question about that. I know that. And it's the elite. Everybody knows a lot of this stuff. The elite, how many families, 200 families or whatever, more perhaps, in the country who have enough money and have been very carefully educated, whether they're Bones or even some other fraternities that are close to Bones. But I think one of the best quotes, and it's pretty simple, it's right in the book cover on Sutton's book. And the reason I like it is because the guy that they're talking about, E.O. Matheson, who was Skull and Bones 1923, was a friend of my father's. I don't think they were very good friends because my father wasn't deeply involved. But my father knew him and had mentioned him. And this is what is right on the cover of the book. It says, quote, this is from E.O. Matheson, Skull and Bones 1923, to Donald Ogden Stewart, an earlier Skull and Bones year, 1916, about Matheson's, Maddie, they called him, upcoming appearance before the House Committee on Un-American Activities. So that's fascinating. Quote, as long as we have somebody from Bones who can bring pressure on the committee, I should think we'd be all right. Now, that tells you the power of someone from Bones. Now, that's Matheson talking to another Bones character. And I knew Matheson's daughter. She lived in Camden when I was on the local school board going up against all these values-destroying programs. And she was from a very elite lady, and she was the daughter of Matheson. And I went to a party, a Christmas party one evening, and, of course, everybody was beating up on me then because I supported grammar, things like that, right? And I didn't like values-destroying programs. But she cornered me at this Christmas party and really beat up on me about my opposition to what was going on in the schools. I was on the school board. And I was so upset that I started to cry. I really, because it was in public that she was doing that. And so I just put my coat on. It was a snowy night. The moon was out and all. And I walked home. And I never forgot that because that was a daughter of an important person in the order. That's the one that I just quoted, huh? So she fell for all the garbage. I didn't. Although my father was never like him. My dad would never have been involved in hearings in Congress and lying and all this stuff.
So, but your dad, as he was dying, did talk about Bohemian Grove and
well, my dad, I want to correct you on this, Alex. My dad was not a member of Bohemian Grove. He was invited once.
Sure, okay.
By Edwin Blair, who was a very close friend of his. I think, they were roommates, but very close.
Sure, sorry, I got confused by that. But, I mean, to be specific, your dad did say that he didn't like it.
He went, because he was invited, he went and spent 10 days or something out there, and he came home, and he said it was very lush, very elegant, very interesting lectures and all, but he would never go back. He said that. I will never go back. So that was dead. Now, I can defend my father. I cannot really defend my grandfather that much, although I loved him, and he was a mining engineer. And he was very prominent, and he was probably one of the top in the world in the late 1890s.
Wasn't Harding a mining engineer, too?
What's that?
Harding, President Harding.
I don't know.
But I mean, to be specific here, though, Charlotte, I'm not saying your dad was a bad guy. He was a great guy, obviously, and through his daughter, this information comes to us as well. I just, going back into memory, I remember you saying that your dad said, basically that he disagreed with it all now and that he didn't
it. What he said, he really didn't say that. He never got that close to what it all was. He said to me a week before he died, because I was really on my white horse. It was getting my horse very dirty now, huh? But I was on my white horse from 1970 to right now, and And he knew what I was doing. And he said, before he died, Char, if I had more time, I'd help you. And so, yeah, I think that he, you know, he was a mayor of three towns on Long Island and in New Jersey. He was an Episcopalian, and he went to church. He was a good Christian, all that. Now, my grandfather was a Mason. My grandfather came from Pennsylvania. He was the one that I do believe, God, you know, please, Grandpa, forgive me. He's the one who was very close to the Fabians in South Africa. He was out there. He opened up the gold mines in the late 1880s in Johannesburg. And I had a picture of him with Sir A. Bailey. I can't find that picture. I don't know where it is. But anyway,
Grandpa... So that's the Cecil Rhodes connection right there.
Absolutely. So Grandpa really was involved, I think. But on the other hand, he was my grandfather, and he was very dear to me, and I loved him. And he was not a snob. That's very interesting. Grandpa was the last person on earth you'd call a snob. And my father, too. The whole family's always been very, you know, we just sort of get along with everybody. No
well,
matter
sure,
who.
Charlotte, and we're not here to put your family on trial for your dad and grandfather being Skull and Bones members.
No, but I just want to make the point here that they're not all what people think they are. It's really interesting. I mean, I knew my father's best friends. They were all in his wedding. You know, when the Skull and Bones guy gets married, all the ushers are the members of Skull and Bones in that class. And then from that time on, you see them all the time. They were visiting the house. I mean, they were my parents' best friends and their wives. Huh? And they were, you never, never, never would have known what the basic, what their goals were. There was one who I remember in particular. My sister's father, godfather, huh? And very nice. And he, believe it or not, was the founder of the Hemlock Society.
Which pushes suicide.
Did you hear me? Well, yeah. I mean, this sort of thing really did surprise me.
Well, I mean, let's talk about what it is, because from Sutton's research, the info we've got, it is certainly a death cult, a Germanic death cult, and its mainline books have now been written. Clearly, you've got the Illuminati going on in Germany at the time. It's founded 1832, German money, British money, the skull and bone symbol worn on the Nazi caps. Specifically, though, what is the end game goal from what you've researched and what you know? I mean, what is Skull and Bones? What are they after?
Well, you know, I think half of them or two-thirds of them are just little boys. You know, they think they're playing little boys' games, right? A third of them mean big business, huh? I mean, one of my father's roommates, who I really liked very well, his name was Charles Spofford, and he was a very fine man, and I have nothing but good things to say about him. But when I was in the State Department in the late 50s in Middle Eastern affairs, all of a sudden I was in the elevator when the Suez Canal was blowing up or something was going on. Something was always going on out there. But anyway, on the elevator is Chuck Spofford. And so I said, hello, Mr. Spofford, and I found out that he was the legal counsel from Davis Polk for the Suez Canal Company.
Ah.
Huh? Okay. Now, that, I did write about that in, not in Anthony's book, but in Fleshing Out Skull and Bones. I have a chapter in that book, right? I was asked to do a chapter in that book, which basically tells a lot of this stuff that we're talking about right now, Alex. So, anyway, Charles Spofford died, finally died, and interesting story. He had a horrible stroke, and he was divorced from his sort of fancy wife. He ended up marrying this lovely woman who I had known at Davis Polk when I worked there as a legal secretary. He married this gal who didn't have any fancy background or anything. She's a wonderful woman. And he spent the rest of his life, being taken care of by her. Now, these are the weird things about Skull and Bones people. You know, I mean, here he was, very famous all over the world. You could type his name in, Charles Spofford. He's a member of everything, the French Croix de Guerre, the blah, blah, blah. You know what my father said about him once? Oh, yes. He did. This is funny. at the dining room table once. My dad, he sat back. I guess he maybe had a few drinks. And he had a cigar, and he was talking about, you know, he said, boy, it's really interesting how Chuck got that promotion. And I said, what are you talking about? And he said, well, you know, Chuck Spofford, the one I'm talking about now, he said, when he was just a private or something, or a lieutenant in World War II in Europe, but after he got promoted to being the undersecretary for NATO or something, and Dad said, you know, it's really interesting how some people can rise to the top.
Yeah, he was making a joke. Charlotte, we're almost out of time. All of this is intriguing information. Aaron, you've got comments about Skull and Bones.
Just a little bit about Avril Harriman, who was one of the major players in the 20th century. Hi, Charlotte, by the way.
Hi there, Aaron.
Nice to talk to you. Yeah, I saw his name in the membership list you have. He has a bio maybe two-thirds of a page long, and his public bio just shows how much he was involved with Russian diplomacy. It's on record that he knew Stalin more than any other person not from Russia. And yeah. Then you read Tarpley and you read Sutton and these other authors about how much he and Prescott Bush at Brown Brothers Harriman were involved in setting up the Soviet Union.
Oh, absolutely, yes. Harriman is such an important one. And, it's just pure evil. That's all I can say. Any order like that, we start studying it or what their goals are. You know, even if they hadn't done all these awful things, you know, the games they play and the horrible, you know, what they go through to become a member, that I couldn't understand. My father was very sound, you know, a very sound person. I can't even imagine him going through those ridiculous...
Well, he's young. That's why the elite put their children into these organizations, is so it can be done by their peers, because they know they'll do things that peers say that they wouldn't do if their parents were telling them to do it. In fact, specifically, let's go back to your son... And his research into the clock, and I've done other research in other occultic orders where they can basically do a spell where they claim that this spirit is attached to you as long as the clock is still moving.
Well, I think that's probably what Samuel was talking about.
Yeah.
But you know what I did to it? I had these three gold copper balls on the top of it, and they needed to be repaired. So the guy at the shop said, well, look, I'll give you three eagles for the time being, Charlotte. So we took the gold balls off. There's three of them on the top of the clock. And I put three eagles up there. And, you know, Skull and Bones must be having hysterics.
Yeah, we've shown the photo of that clock. We'll show it again here in a moment. But specifically from your son's research into it, I mean, what other occultic information do you have? Or was there anything, any other little things that your father was concerned about?
No, I really can't be very helpful on that.
Well, I know that...
What I have to say about the order and the lack of attention to certain very important things that they've been doing, it's okay to write about the order. You can say anything you want about the order, but don't touch education. And that we know, because that, what's her name, Samantha, what's her name, the gal who wrote the book, when Tony's book was coming out on fleshing out Skull and Bones?
Alexandra Thompson, I believe.
Yeah, well, whatever.
She wrote
it is,
Secrets of the Tomb. Let me look up her name real quick. Go ahead.
Yes.
Yes.
It's important to point this out, because just before America's Secret Establishment by Sutton came out, they found out, and they got her to write that book, I think. This is what I've heard, okay? And if you look at her book and any other book that's been written or allowed to be reviewed or whatever, you see nothing about education. Nothing.